From New York, this is Democracy Now!
Enough is enough. It's time to release Mr. Peltier. And that Senator Schatz would put that in a letter, a well-written letter, as concisely as he did, again, puts this right on the desk of the president. He's got to deal with this. He's got to correct this wrong.
Pressure is growing on President Biden to commute the life sentence of Native American activist Leonard Peltier, who has spent 46 years in prison. Peltier is 77 years old and has just tested positive for COVID. Amnesty International considers him a political prisoner who was not granted a fair trial. We'll speak to his lawyer, Kevin Sharp, a former federal judge. Then President Biden set to meet with New York's new mayor, Eric Adams, this week after Adams announced his plan to end gun violence.
We will start by putting more officers on patrol in key neighborhoods throughout the city.
We'll look at the national debate over policing with Patrice Cullors. She's one of the founders of Black Lives Matter and author of the new book, An Abolitionist Handbook, 12 Steps to Changing Yourself and the World.
We have created a system that over-relies on law enforcement and prioritizes their money, their budget, their needs over everything else. Now is the time that we redirect resources back into our communities.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The UN Security Council is holding an emergency session today over ongoing tension at the Russia-Ukraine border. Russia's amassed some 100,000 troops near Ukraine, but denies it plans to invade and continues to demand NATO commit to halting its eastward expansion. The U.S. Senate is expected to unveil a bill imposing possible new sanctions on Russia, including some that could take effect even before any possible invasion. The U.K. also threatened to impose new sanctions against Russia on Friday. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said Western panic over the situation is destabilizing Ukraine's economy.
The politics have to be balanced. And the journalists, if they want to understand the situation, let them come to Kiev. Are tanks driving here in our streets? No, but it feels like this if you're reading the media. If you're not here, then you feel like this.
On Friday, President Biden told reporters he'll soon move U.S. troops to NATO countries in Eastern Europe. Meanwhile, NATO's Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said members of its military alliance are offering training and equipment to Ukraine, but that there are, quote, no plans to deploy NATO combat troops to Ukraine, unquote. Nearly 2,000 child soldiers in Yemen have died in combat since 2020, according to UN investigators. Houthi rebels have pressed children as young as seven into the fight against the Saudi-led coalition, with kids in one summer camp taught to clean weapons and evade rockets. The report also found Saudi-led forces continue to inflict heavy casualties on Yemen civilians. The UN says violations of international law have become the norm rather than the exception in Yemen. This comes as the United Arab Emirates say they intercepted and destroyed a ballistic missile fired by Yemen's Houthi rebels amidst the ongoing attacks between the parties. Israel's president is now on an official visit to Abu Dhabi for the first time 16 months after the two nations normalized relations. A new report from the UN finds over 100 people who previously worked for the Afghan government, its security forces or international military forces, have been killed since last August's takeover of Afghanistan by the Taliban. The UN says more than two-thirds of them were killed extrajudicially by the Taliban or its affiliates, despite promises of amnesty by Taliban leaders. Civil society activists and journalists have also been targeted and killed. In Sudan, security forces killed a 27-year-old pro-democracy demonstrator Sunday as thousands of people defied a protest ban and took to the streets of Khartoum and other cities to call for an end to the military coup regime.
Despite everything that is happening and despite all the martyrs who are dying, every day we lose a martyr, but people insist on their goal. We will gain victory. They are firing bullets now, and the revolution continues.
At least 79 protesters have been killed since Sudan's October 25th coup. In 2019, a popular uprising led to the ouster of the former authoritarian president Omar al-Bashir, but Sudan's transition to democratic rule has been derailed by the coup and leadership struggles. North Korea tested what appeared to be its longest-range ballistic missile since 2017 Sunday, a move South Korea said was a violation of United Nations Security Council resolutions. It was North Korea's third such test in the last week and seventh since the start of the year. Biden administration officials said they again appealed to Kim Jong-un to join direct talks following Sunday's launch, but the U.S. has rejected North Korean demands for sanctions relief and imposed new ones in recent weeks. In Ecuador, the operator of a privately held pipeline has shut down the flow of heavy crude oil after the pipeline ruptured in the Amazon. OCP Ecuador claimed the spill had burst in an area not connected to waterways, but members of the Quechua indigenous community shared video showing contamination on rivers in their territory. This is environmentalist Juan Pablo Fajardo.
We see that it's a high-magnitude spill. It's believed that water sources and third parties were affected. It's considered a Category 3 spill. That is what has happened, and contingency measures from the operator have been requested.
In Peru, a judge has barred four executives with the Spanish oil company Repsol from leaving the country after nearly 12,000 barrels of oil leaked into the ocean January 15th. The spill was triggered by a tsunami from a massive volcanic eruption in Tonga. It was Peru's largest environmental disaster in years. Meanwhile, authorities in eastern Thailand are fighting to prevent a 13,000-gallon oil spill from damaging fragile coral reefs and reaching a popular resort island. The audio streaming app Spotify announced it's adding content advisories to podcasts that discuss COVID-19 and directing listeners to external resources on the pandemic in order to combat misinformation. The move comes amidst mounting controversy over Spotify's decision to remove Neil Young's songs after he told the streaming company to choose between his music or hosting the show of popular podcaster and COVID conspiracy theorist Joe Rogan. On Friday, Joni Mitchell announced she is removing her music catalog from Spotify, quote, in solidarity with Neil Young and the global scientific and medical communities, unquote. Meanwhile, Joe Rogan's apologized for the backlash, admitting his show is, quote, an out-of-control juggernaut and vowed to balance things out in the future, he said. In Georgia, two of the three men convicted of murdering Ahmaud Arbery reached a plea deal with the Justice Department in their federal hate crimes case, according to court documents. Lawyers and the family of Ahmaud Arbery, who was chased down and shot dead by the men while out jogging in 2020, condemned the, quote, backroom plea deal and are appearing in court today to oppose it. The deal would reportedly allow Gregory and Travis McMichael to serve the first 30 years of their life sentences in a federal prison instead of a state prison and avoid their federal trial. Donald Trump held a rally in Texas Saturday where he teased a possible presidential run and defended people charged for their involvement in the deadly January 6th Capitol insurrection.
If I run and if I win, we will treat those people from January 6th fairly. We will treat them fairly. And if it requires pardons, we will give them pardons because they are being treated so unfairly.
Trump called for mass protests if prosecutors find him guilty of attempting to overturn the 2020 election results or of financial crimes through his businesses. On Sunday, Trump released a statement confirming he wanted then-Vice President Mike Pence to overturn the 2020 presidential election, falsely claiming Pence had the authority to do so. In related news, the House committee investigating the insurrection subpoenaed 14 people Friday who lied about being electors for Trump in states that were won by Joe Biden. In another blow to voting rights, a Pennsylvania court Friday struck down a state law that expanded mail-in voting. The court ruled Pennsylvania's constitution requires voters cast their ballots in person on Election Day unless they meet certain criteria. The law, called Act 77, will remain in place while an appeal is resolved. A group of 14 Pennsylvania Republicans sued over the legislation after former President Trump lost the state to President Biden in 2020. At least 11 of them had voted in favor of passing Act 77 in 2019. In other voting news, New York State lawmakers unveiled a proposed redrawn congressional map Sunday that could give Democrats as many as three more seats in the U.S. House. A Pennsylvania man who was cleared of a murder conviction and released from prison after 37 years has filed a lawsuit accusing the city of Philadelphia of outrageous police misconduct. Willie Stokes, an African-American man, was convicted of murder in 1984. The two detectives who were involved in the case are accused of offering sex and drugs to a witness in exchange for false testimony against Stokes. The witness, who recanted his accusation during the murder trial, was charged with perjury just days after Stokes was convicted. But Stokes did not have access to this information until 2015, decades into his life sentence. Stokes was released from prison earlier this month, and his murder conviction was formally dismissed last Thursday. And here in New York, former Miss USA Chesley Christ died Sunday morning after jumping from a building in Manhattan. She'd won the pageant in 2019. Christ was an attorney and an advocate for Black Lives Matter. She worked pro bono with prisoners fighting for criminal justice reform. In a statement, her family said, quote, "Her great light was one that inspired others around the world with her beauty and strength. She cared, she loved, she laughed, and she shined." Chesley Christ was 30 years old. In the United States, the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline is 1-800-273-8255. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. When we come back, pressure's growing on President Biden to commute the life sentence of Native American activist Leonard Peltier, who has spent 46 years in prison. We'll speak to his lawyer, a former judge. Stay with us.
You know, we have a million stories to tell. I'm just one of a million or more stories that can be told.
Sacrifice by Robbie Robertson, featuring the voice of Leonard Peltier. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The jailed Native American activist Leonard Peltier has tested positive for COVID, less than a week after describing his prison as a torture chamber. Pelter, who suffers from multiple health conditions, says he and others held at the Coleman Federal Correctional Complex in Florida have yet to receive their COVID booster shots and describes worsening neglect and uncertainty. In a statement, Leonard Peltier writes, "Left alone and without attention is like a torture chamber for the sick and old." The 77-year-old Leonard Peltier is a Lakota and Chippewa Native American from the state of North Dakota. He's been jailed for 46 years. In 1977, he was convicted of killing two FBI agents during a shootout on South Dakota's Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in 1975. At the time, Peltier was a member of AIM, the American Indian Movement. He's always maintained his innocence. Amnesty International considers him a political prisoner who was not granted a fair trial. The 1975 shootout occurred 2 years after AIM occupied the village of Wounded Knee for 71 days. The occupation of Wounded Knee is considered the beginning of what Oglala people refer to as the Reign of Terror. During that time, some 64 local Native Americans were murdered. Most of them had ties to AIM. Their deaths went uninvestigated by the FBI. Over the past 25 years, indigenous and human rights groups lobbied both President Clinton and President Obama to pardon Leonard Peltier, but they refused. Now President Biden is facing pressure to do so. On Wednesday, Senator Brian Schatz, who's chair of the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs, wrote a letter to Biden urging him to commute Peltier's sentence. We're joined now by Leonard Peltier's lawyer, Kevin Sharp. Kevin Sharp is a former federal judge who resigned from the bench to fight against mandatory minimum laws. He's joining us from Nashville, Tennessee. Welcome to Democracy Now! Do we call you Judge Sharp, even though you have left your judgeship?
You know, it's one of the few things I get to hang on to.
So, Judge Sharp,
the title.
First, if you can tell us about Leonard's condition, and then talk about why you took on his case.
Well, the condition part is tough because it's difficult to get information out of the BOP, the Bureau of Prisons. He tested positive on Friday, and so there were people there that I was able to talk to. Over the weekend, you have a very skeleton crew, and there's really not much information I could get, although they would talk to me briefly, except to say he's doing okay and has not had to been moved yet. So far, so good. As soon as this segment is over, I'm going to call the prison again, and I should be able to get a hold of his counselor. But that's where we are. He has COVID. He's feeling really poorly. This is the information I had on Friday, and he's been quarantined. And so that's kind of where we are.
So, Judge Sharp, talk about why you took on Leonard Peltier's case.
You know, that's interesting, because when I stepped down from the bench, I started working on clemency for a young man that I had sentenced to life in prison. I thought that it was a mandatory minimum sentence, very unfair, and I started working on clemency for him. And ultimately, we were able to get clemency from President Trump. But Kim Kardashian got involved in that case. And with Kim's involvement came a lot of media attention. That media attention caught the attention of a woman, Willie Nelson's ex-wife, Connie Nelson, in Texas, who asked someone to send me all of the information on Leonard's case. I sat down to read the stacks, just reams of information on Leonard's case, not really coming at it with any preconceived notion. I didn't know much about it. I was only 12 years old when the events happened, so I didn't know much. And I came at this looking at it from the viewpoint of a federal judge. And what I saw was shocking. The constitutional violations just continued to stack up. And I was really outraged that this man was still in prison, knowing what everyone now knew. And so with that, I agreed to take on this case pro bono.
So, Kevin Sharp, I sort of laid out the case of Leonard Peltier. But can you, after reviewing it, looking at all the documents, knowing what you know as a judge and a lawyer, lay out Leonard Peltier's case? What most shocked you about it? And then what are your grounds now for asking for the commutation of his sentence?
Well, they relate to each other. The things that most shocked me was the level of outright misconduct by the U.S. Attorney's Office, the then U.S. Attorney's Office, and the then FBI. What they did in the form of intimidating and threatening witnesses, hiding exculpatory evidence, suborning perjury, and all of that is known. When Leonard appealed all of these issues over the years, some of it was known, some of it wasn't, but the standards were different. And if this case were brought up today, no question, this verdict gets overturned. And ultimately, even the U.S. Attorney's Office had to admit that they don't know who killed the agents. And so we're sitting here with the prosecutor saying, we don't know who did it. But sure, a life sentence for this man seems fine. As a matter of fact, in the early 90s, 60 Minutes did a segment on this, and they talked to the assisting U.S. attorney who tried the case and specifically asked him about perjury of one of the witnesses, a woman named Myrtle Poorbear. And initially, the AUSA said, I didn't know it was perjured testimony. But then he looks in the camera and says, but so what if I did? it doesn't bother my conscience one whit. And at that, I'm looking at that going, they knew it, and he's admitting it here on national television. What they did was outrageous and completely ignoring the Constitution of the United States so that they could get a conviction. Part of the reason for that kind of fervor to get a conviction at any cost is because his co-defendants were acquitted based on self-defense. So he's really their last chance at getting a conviction. And so it was a conviction at any cost. Now, once it was discovered, one of the things they had done was withhold exculpatory evidence. That's evidence that tends to show the person is not guilty of the crime you're accusing them of committing. And that exculpatory evidence in this case was a ballistics test that they had testified did not exist, when in fact it did exist. And it wasn't discovered for years afterwards. So by withholding that ballistics test, it deprived Mr. Peltier of a fair trial. Constitution requires that be shown. So, you know, these things just stack up. And that's what so outraged me.
I want to go back to Election Day 2000. I had a chance to interview then-President Bill Clinton. He had called our radio station, Pacifica Station WBAI, in an attempt to get out the vote for Hillary Clinton for Senate and Al Gore for president. So I used the opportunity to ask him about the case of Leonard Peltier.
President Clinton, since it's rare to get you on the phone, let me ask you another question. That is, what is your position on granting Leonard Peltier, the Native American activist, executive clemency?
Well, I don't have a position I can announce yet. I think I believe there is a new application for him in there. And when I have time after the election's over, I'm going to review all the remaining executive clemency applications. And you know, see what the merits dictate. I will try to do what I think the right thing to do is based on the evidence.
So I now want to turn to Leonard Peltier in his own words. Shortly after I interviewed President Clinton in 2000, I spoke to Leonard when he was being held at the Leavenworth Federal Penitentiary in Kansas.
My name is Leonard Peltier. I'm a Lakota and Chippewa Native American from the state of North Dakota. I am currently serving two life sentences for the deaths of two FBI agents in Leavenworth, United States Penitentiary.
Did you kill the FBI agents?
No, I did not. No.
Maybe we could go back to that day that these FBI agents were killed, and you could tell us what happened.
Well, at that time, there was a what is known as today's a region of terror going on against traditional people from the so-called progressives under a tribal chairman named Dick Wilson, who was very corrupt, who organized his own private police force, kind of like a Contra group, and started terrorizing his own people, his own traditionalists on the reservation. So the traditionalists asked for the help of the American Indian Movement. And the end results of, after long protests and not getting no responses from many law enforcement agency in the country, Wounded Knee 2 was then occupied, and there was a 71-day siege. After that, Dick Wilson again intensified his goon squads, and the General Accounting Service, an agency of the United States government, did an investigation, and before the funding was ran out, they found over 60 murdered Indian people, traditionalists and stuff. On June 26th, we didn't know it at the time, but we knew later from Freedom of Information documents that FBI with the goon squads were planning on attacks on the Jumping Bull Ranch and another ranch in Kyle. That's another community on the reservation, that they were declaring American Indian Movement strongholds. And on June 26th, a firefight started, and the end results was two FBI agents and one young Indian man was killed. And they indicted four of us Bob Robidoux, Dino Butler, Jimmy Eagle. After a year, they dropped the charges on Jimmy Eagle. And Bob and Dino went to trial in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and was found not guilty by reasons of self-defense. I was later, my trial was mysteriously moved from Cedar Rapids, which I was supposed to go to trial the same place under the same judge, as my co-defendants, was mysteriously moved to Fargo, North Dakota. Later documents show that the FBI then went judge shopping to get a judge to work closely with them, and Judge Paul Benson agreed to do it. And, I was not allowed to put up a defense. They manufactured evidence, the murder weapon. It was perjury by government witnesses, and the judge erred in his rulings, which prevented me from putting up a defense.
So that was Leonard Peltier in 2000, over two decades ago. He was at Leavenworth. I spoke to him in 2012. It was the day after a major fundraiser for him at the Beacon Theater, a major concert fundraiser. And there was an event the next day, and it was in that room that he was able to call in. I spoke to him on the phone from prison. At that point, he was in Florida, and this was during the Obama administration. Leonard, this is Amy Goodman from Democracy Now! I was
wondering.
Hi, I'm good. I was wondering if you have a message for President Obama.
I just hope he can, stop the wars that are going on in the world and stop getting, killing all those people getting killed and, give the Black Hills back to my people and turn me loose.
Can you share with people at the news conference and with President Obama your case for why you should be, your sentence should be commuted, why you want clemency?
Well, I never got a fair trial, for one. They wouldn't allow me to put up a defense. And manufactured evidence, manufactured witnesses, tortured witnesses. The list just goes on. So I think I'm a very good candidate for, after 37 years, for clemency, or house arrest, at least.
So that was Leonard Peltier 9 years ago in prison from Florida. Judge Sharp, now Leonard Peltier's lawyer, can you talk about the significance of what he said in these two conversations, and also the first one speaking to him during Clinton? In fact, wasn't President Clinton close to granting him clemency, and then under Obama, and what you hope will be different under President Biden?
Well, yes. Let me kind of take those in pieces. What Leonard said was accurate. Most of what he said, some of it was because he was there, so he's got his own personal accounts, and some of it is backed up by documents turned over during the Freedom of Information Act, or through a Freedom of Information Act request. We now know that the witnesses were intimidated. He's absolutely right about that. We now know that exculpatory evidence showing this was not his weapon that killed the agents, we now know that was hidden. We now know that Myrtle Poorbear was forced to lie. We know that the young boys who were the major witnesses, eyewitnesses against him, recanted that testimony. It wasn't true. So we know those things. Yet here we are 46 years later, still talking about whether or not this man should be freed. The U.S. Attorney's Office, the federal government, says we do not know who killed the agents. They ended up, because of all of the misconduct that was discovered in the trial, they changed their theory from one that he shot these agents to aiding and abetting. Well, then the question becomes, who did he aid and abet? Because his co-defendants were acquitted based on self-defense. So who did he aid and abet? When asked that question, the assistant U.S. attorney, in one sense, a flippant response was, I don't know, maybe himself. Well, that's impossible. There, you cannot aid and abet yourself. So, all of those things stacked up with time tell you this enough is enough. And I realize I say that, but it is absolutely true. This has to end. And yes, my understanding from talking to the people involved at the time of the Clinton administration was that the papers were on his desk to be signed. Why they weren't signed, I don't know. The same with President Obama. I don't know how close he got. But it tells you there is a constituency. The big misconception about this is that Leonard Peltier was convicted of shooting two agents. He was not. They had to drop that because there was the evidence that they had presented that he had shot two agents was false. It was perjury. It was manufactured. So they had to drop that case and come up with a new theory. And that theory was aiding and abetting. And when Leonard talks about not being able to put on his defense, one of the things that Judge Benson said was when he excluded the evidence related to the misconduct in the Reign of Terror was that the FBI is not on trial here. But once he did that, you have to put all of this in context. That's why Judge Heaney, who was on the Eighth Circuit, who heard his appeal, and although upheld the conviction, later came out himself in favor of commuting this sentence, said that federal government has to take responsibility for what happened here. And absolutely they do. Context matters. But the lack of evidence that this man killed someone also matters. And so it's time. We're now 46 years later. You've got a 77-year-old man with multiple health issues, and his tribe, the Turtle Mountain Band of Chippewa, saying, "We will embrace him. Please send him home to us." And that's what I'm asking the president to do, send him home.
Judge Sharp, what did J. Edgar Hoover have to do with this case, the former head of the FBI at the time?
You know, that comes back into COINTELPRO, where there was a division inside the FBI tasked with running counterintelligence against our own citizens. And they did that with, you know, with respect to Martin Luther King, student nonviolent movement, the Black Panthers, and the American Indian movement. If they considered them to be subversive, then they were running counterintelligence against them. And so, although Hoover was gone by 1975, we're only one director removed from Hoover, and the tactics, if not a group within the FBI that had that name, the tactics still existed. And that's exactly what was happening. It's very Vietnam-esque.
And I wanted to read a part of Senator Schatz's letter, the senator from Hawaii, who appealed to President Biden. He is chair of the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs. He wrote, "Mr. Peltier meets appropriate criteria for commutation. Number one, his old age and critical illness. Number two, the amount of time he's already served. And number three, the unavailability of other remedies." Explain what he's saying.
Well, there is the ability to release prisoners under compassionate release, and as part of the commutation powers of the President of the United States. And he's asking the president, based on those criteria, to end this and send Leonard home. And he's absolutely right about that. This is, and I hear this from executives who say, "Well, the criminal justice system worked. I'm not going to step in and inject myself into the criminal justice system." What they are doing, though, is abdicating their responsibility as part of the criminal justice system. The president or a governor, in the case of a state, that they are the criminal justice system, and they have the ability to step in and correct a wrong like this, where the legal remedies, particularly because of the standard of review at the time, the legal remedies are no longer available. Now it's time for the BOP and the President of the United States to fix this and send him home.
I want to end by reading more from Leonard Peltier's statement on the current conditions inside the Coleman prison. Leonard Peltier writes, "I'm in hell. and there's no way to deal with it but to take it as long as you can. I cling to the belief that people are out there doing what they can to change our circumstances in here. The fear and stress are taking a toll on everyone, including the staff. You can see it in their faces and hear it in their voices. The whole institution is on total lockdown. He says, in and out of lockdown last year at least meant a shower every third day, a meal beyond a sandwich wet with a little peanut butter. But now with COVID for an excuse, nothing. No phone, no window, no fresh air, no humans to gather, no loved one's voice, no relief. Left alone and without attention is like a torture chamber for the sick and old. He writes, where are our human rights activists? You are hearing from me and with me many desperate men and women. They are turning an already harsh environment into an asylum. And for many who did not receive a death penalty, we are now staring down the face of one. Help me, my brothers and sisters. Help me, my good friends. Those are the words of jailed Native American leader Leonard Peltier after 46 years in prison, now at the Coleman Prison in Florida. Judge Kevin Sharp is his new judge and is his new lawyer and is appealing for clemency from President Biden. Finally, Kevin Sharp, has President Biden responded to your plea?
He has not. And I noticed in the press conference last week, a reporter asked him about that. Or asked the press secretary about that, and she begged off of that, said, you know, it's she was unable to answer that question. So, you know, I know that it's on the president's radar, and he has the opportunity to fix this, and he has the opportunity to be a president with courage and a president who cares about the United States Constitution. It's you know, pick up the pen and sign the paper and let's end this. Let's stop talking about this. The FBI says we are not the FBI of the 1970s. And I believe them. But now let's show it. Show it and support clemency for Mr. Peltier.
Kevin Sharp is a former federal judge and now an attorney who represents Leonard Peltier. Again, the latest news, Leonard Peltier is sick with COVID. Next up, President Biden's meeting with New York's new mayor, Eric Adams. Both want to put more police on the street. We'll look at the national debate over policing with Patrice Cullors, one of the founders of Black Lives Matter, author of a new book, An Abolitionist Handbook. Stay with us. Of Octavia E. Butler by Sons of Kemet. To see our interview with the great writer, Octavia Butler, you can go to democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. This is Democracy Now! President Biden comes to New York City this Wednesday to meet with the mayor, Eric Adams, about gun violence. He said in a statement, the effort will include, quote, historic levels of funding for cities and states to put more cops on the beat, among other strategies. This comes as Mayor Adams delivered the eulogy at a funeral Friday attended by thousands of police officers for Officer Jason Rivera, who was shot to death along with his partner while responding to a domestic violence call. Mayor Adams is an African-American former police captain who took office this year after campaigning training on public safety. Last week, he released his blueprint to end gun violence with plans to rely heavily on plainclothes police officers to make gun arrests. The announcement drew alarm because these officers have a documented history of discriminatory policing through stop and frisk and were involved in the police killing of Amadou Diallo, Sean Bell, and Eric Garner. This is Mayor Adams.
The NYPD is our first line of defense against gun violence. We will make new efforts to strengthen and reinforce it while continuing our mission to involve the community. We will start by putting more officers on patrol in key neighborhoods throughout the city. We will enhance existing public safety units with new neighborhood safety teams, which will focus on gun violence. We will launch these additional teams in the next 3 weeks with deep focus on 30 precincts where 80% of violence occurs, even as the public safety units continue their life-saving work. In doing this, we will avoid mistakes of the past. These officers will be identifiable as NYPD. They will have body cameras, and they will have enhanced training and oversight.
Police accountability advocates have called Adams' 15-page plan a Trojan horse that would be a major setback for efforts to defund the police. It comes amidst a nationwide discussion of how to address public safety without relying on police and jails and prisons. Mayor Adams has also vowed to reinstate solitary confinement at the notorious Rikers Island jail complex, where inhumane conditions during the pandemic have already led to a hunger strike by prisoners echoed by others incarcerated nationwide. To discuss this and so much more, we're joined by Patrice Cullors, author, educator, artist, and abolitionist. She's co-founder of Black Lives Matter and a founder of Reform LA Jails. Last year, she stepped away from her role as executive director of Black Lives Matter Global Network Foundation. Patrice's new book is just out. It's titled An Abolitionist's Handbook, 12 Steps to Changing Yourself and the World. She's also author of her memoir, When They Call You a Terrorist, a Black Lives Matter memoir. Patrice, welcome back to Democracy Now! Congratulations on your new book. Could you start off by defining abolition?
Sure. I mean, it's a simple definition, which is abolition is getting rid of police, prisons, jail, surveillance, and the current court system as we know it.
So let me just ask a quick question that might be confusing for many. When you have someone like Derek Chauvin or the McMasters, who were found guilty of murdering Ahmaud Arbery, the McMichaels, police officer, former police officer, and his son, what should happen to them? Should they be imprisoned?
It's a good question, and it's a question that many abolitionists are thinking about and talking about. But I want to say that abolition isn't devoid of accountability. And so when we talk about abolition, we don't say that we aren't holding people accountable for harm that is caused. But we don't think the current system of accountability actually meets the needs of the community that is harmed. And so listening to the current mayor of New York rattle off 80s and 90s rhetoric around law and order is deeply disturbing, because we know that the 80s and 90s rhetoric and policy only decimated our communities. And so when we have these conversations about what we do with white supremacists, what do we do with vigilantes, what do we do with law enforcement, this current system of accountability, the criminal legal system, it doesn't actually get us to the place where we want to get to. It doesn't transform the communities that we're in. It doesn't stop white supremacy. It doesn't stop vigilante violence.
So we started with the headline being New York, because Biden's coming here and he's going to meet with Adams, a former police officer who, in fact, actually sued the New York Police Department for racism. But we'll put that aside for a moment. I'm talking to you in Los Angeles, and you are very active on prison and jail issues in Los Angeles, and you've had many victories. Explain what's going on there and how you fit that into the abolitionist framework.
Of course. Well, we spent almost two decades here in Los Angeles challenging what was going to be a jail expansion effort that would have been a $3.5 billion, not million, $3.5 billion jail plan here in Los Angeles. And in that challenging, we were met with little to no attention. For a long time, the county board of supervisors told us these jails are being built. This is for public safety. And then, as organizing does, it challenged and changed many of the elected officials who are sitting on the board, and we effectively stopped those jails from being built. But not only did we stop the jails from being built, we really created a new model around how we vision Los Angeles County that can focus on things like mental health, focus on things like having our community have access to green space, having our community have access to mental health care, having our community have access to food, housing, jobs. And so we have really pushed and challenged both the county and the city here in Los Angeles to recreate a model here in LA that does put abolition first, does put care first in this city. And frankly, we're winning. I'm deeply concerned about the move to continue to fund police departments as a way to deal with harm and violence. We've seen time and time again that it actually doesn't work. What works is when communities have access to their basic needs, when communities have access to being able to be full, dignified human beings.
In an abolitionist handbook, you draw on your father's experience in AA, the 12 steps to lay out, the 12 steps to transforming yourself and the world. Talk about that.
You know, I wanted to write a book that could both help the person who's on their journey towards abolition or confused about abolition, but also for those of us who've been in abolition work for a long time. Much of the conversation of abolition has a lot to do with the ending of the current criminal legal system. But I believe that abolition is more than that. Abolition has everything to do with how we engage with each other, how we treat each other. If we're living in the current environment of what I call an economy of punishment, where our interactions are really undergirded by vengeance and punishment, then I'm really calling for something else, which is, how do we relate to and build an economy of care? And that's an abolitionist framework, one that really centers the care of human beings and all living beings. And so this book gives charts that with both my real life experiences. Also, you know, I look to different activists. So every chapter ends with a leader, both either living or an ancestor that has practiced abolition in real time. I also, you know, tell my readers to look at other people's books. And so abolition is not something we do individually. Abolition is something that we do inside of community. And I'm really trying to push the readers to live inside of that practice.
Your book that you wrote that I consider one of the best books that I have read, When They Call You a Terrorist, where you talk about your brother Monty, who deals with mental health issues. Talk about how that fits into your abolitionist critique of what we're seeing right now and what jails and prisons do.
Sure. You know, I was listening to your segment about Leonard Peltier right before, and was moved to tears hearing his plea to us on the outside to get him the support, get him out of what he is calling hell. I can't tell you how many times as a young person that I had to get those types of letters from my brother or my father or different family members of mine telling me that what's inside of our jail system is beyond inhumane, it's torture. And I grew up reading those letters. I grew up thinking there has to be more than this. My brother, who I'm now the primary caregiver for, who suffers from severe mental illness, wasn't diagnosed in a hospital. He wasn't diagnosed in a treatment center. In fact, he was diagnosed in Twin Towers, one of the worst jail facilities in the world that, quote, treat people with mental illness. I understood at a young age that what we have now, jails and prisons, these are not things, these places are not places that actually rehabilitate. These places actually torture our family members. These places are places that our family members don't deserve to be in. And so this critique that I have is a critique that I started inside of me as a young child. And I was really, you know, blessed and honored to learn about abolition from critical resistance founded by people like Angela Davis and Ruthie Wilson Gilmore. I consider mentors of mine in this abolitionist movement.
I want to go back to New York City's new mayor, Eric Adams, who's meeting with Biden this week to deal with increasing gun violence. Shooting incidents in New York are up 24% this year compared to the same period last year. During his campaign, Mayor Adams came under fire from the progressive wing of the Democratic Party for endorsing what they said was solitary confinement, but what he termed punitive segregation. This is what he said.
For people to continue to say Eric supports solitary confinement, that is just a lie. I support punitive segregation. I am not going to be in a city where dangerous people assault innocent people, go to jail, and assault more people. If you are violent, you must be removed from population so that you don't inflict violence on other people. That's clear.
So that's New York Mayor Adams. Patrice Cullors, your response.
If our goal is to rehabilitate human beings who cause harm, if our goal is to transform those human beings, we have to actually treat them with compassion and care. Does it mean that we don't hold them accountable for what they've done? All we've seen solitary confinement do, or what he's calling punitive segregation do, is deteriorate human beings. And I believe the goal that we have as people who are, you know, public figures, elected officials, is to transform the person who's caused harm and also transform the conditions that they come from. Putting more cops, more law enforcement in the streets doesn't actually transform the conditions that currently exist in our communities.
So you talk a lot about non-reform reforms, and you talk about transformation. Talk more about transformation.
Sure. I want to talk about why I believe in non-reformist reforms. And, you know, much of that really comes from an abolitionist critique of how we've dealt with this conversation of law enforcement for years. I heard the mayor speak about body cameras as if body cameras stops police violence. In fact, we've seen here in South Central LA, law enforcement turn off their body cameras. We've seen law enforcement still kill while wearing a body camera. And so a body camera doesn't actually stop the things that we need to transform. When we talk about non-reformist reforms, we're really calling for a divestment out of policing and an investment into the communities who are most harmed, the communities who are dealing with poverty, communities that are dealing with issues of joblessness and houselessness, especially right now during this pandemic. We don't need more law enforcement, Amy. We actually need our communities to have access to housing, jobs, and healthy food. And that is going to be our way towards transformation.
When you write about the role of imagination in the abolitionist work, you cite the work of Adrienne Marie Brown and how she reminds us we must always be, quote, cultivating the muscle of radical imagination needed to dream beyond fear. Elaborate on that.
Sure. One of the most egregious acts of living inside of a white supremacist capitalist patriarchal system is that it's taken our imagination away. Whenever I speak to people about abolition, one of the first guttural reactions is, well, what about the murderers and what about the rapists, as if there aren't other people who are languishing inside of these jails, people with drug addiction, people with mental health disorders. We've lacked this imagination. We believe that police and prisons as we know it have existed for millions of years. It hasn't. It's a short system, and it's a system that hasn't worked for the majority of us. And so we are calling, abolitionists are calling for us to imagine a world without police, imagine a world without prisons. When we did the work here in Los Angeles to stop the $3.5 billion jail plan, the first question we asked our communities, what would you do with $3.5 billion? Let me tell you, not a one human being said we would build more jails and prisons. And so we have to imagine what we would do with these dollars, with these budgets. And they have to really be an imagination that's grounded in care.
You also talk about the role of those who've been incarcerated, who've experienced the brutal impacts of prison and jail, being the leaders of the abolition movement. Can you talk more about that?
Sure. I think a lot about groups, you know, that I created, like Dignity and Power Now, who are really led by incarcerated people and their family members. Groups like Initiate Justice, who is doing statewide work here in California, really challenging sentencing here in California. And I think about work being done by prison feminists, Success Stories, an amazing program that was created inside California state prisons, using bell hooks to challenge men inside prisons to be feminists. There is so much work being led by incarcerated people and their family members who have told us this system that we are inside of does not work for us. I just, the words of Leonard keep, they're so resonant in me right now as he calls for human rights activists to do more. And part of that doing more is calling for abolition.
In An Abolitionist Handbook, 12 Steps to Changing Yourself and the World. Can you talk about the guiding questions? You end each of your 12 chapters with this series of tips and this set of guiding questions.
Yes. I thought about what I would have wanted as a young abolitionist. So much of the text when I was growing up was very academic. And while I enjoyed those texts, I really wanted more workbooks, more handbooks, you know, something where I can just like write in the margins and highlighter up and practice with my friends. And I don't take for granted that, you know, abolition is something that people are can be really scared of, that people can be really intimidated by. So I wanted to end each chapter with a set of questions that people could ask themselves, ask their loved ones, something that can happen around a dinner table, something that can happen in a Zoom room or at a staff meeting. And I found a lot of joy posing those questions. They're questions that I go back to. I've been re-listening to the book, feeling really grateful for these principles because they're principles that I try to live by on a daily basis.
And finally, can you talk about the projects that you're working on now as you move on from the Black Lives Matter movement? Your project with Warner Brothers, working on a scripted project about cannabis, others that look at Black women leaders and the toll, you say, of living under a system that doesn't see us or makes us hyper-visible and also hyper-invisible at the same time.
Sure. I'm really interested in using the storytelling projects that I'm going to be working on to talk about Black women organizers in particular, Black women artists, and having us be protagonists in stories that we're usually not protagonists in. I'm also very interested in aestheticizing abolition. White supremacy and patriarchy has aestheticized itself. It's become a cultural project, not just a political project. So I want to do the same with abolition. I want to show people that abolition is not just a theory inside a book, but it's something that we can practice, and it's something that is culturally relevant for this time.
Well, I want to thank you so much, Patrice Cullors, on being with us and your new book, An Abolitionist Handbook, 12 Steps to Changing Yourself and the World. Patrice Cullors is the New York Times bestselling author of When They Call You a Terrorist. She's an author, educator, artist, and abolitionist, co-founder of Black Lives Matter, and a founder of Reform LA Jails. Last year, stepping away from her role as executive director of the Black Lives Matter Global Network Foundation. And we will link to your writings and others as you move on. That does it for our show. We have a job opening, human resources manager. Learn more and apply at democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Produced with Renee Feltz, Mike Burke, and so many more. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us. Remember, wearing a mask is an act of love.